The time having arrived, I call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to order and ask you to please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. If everyone could remain standing for 1 second, we would just like to ask for a moment of silence from our school family this week. We lost a four-year-old girl, Tina Esposito, a student at the Gilmore School, and we'd like to ask everyone for a moment of silence in Tina's memory. Thank you. Okay, we normally open each meeting with hearing of visitors. That's an opportunity for members of the community to address the school committee, the superintendent, and the mayor. And in order, any resident or any person with a concern can sign in prior to the meeting and be granted 3 minutes of time to address us. This week, no one signed in to be heard. So we'll go right on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is a block of generally routine business and items before the school committee that we treat as one entity in order to keep the meeting moving along. However, any individual member of the school committee may request that an individual item be withdrawn from the consent agenda for individual discussion and consideration. So at this time, I'll ask if any members of the committee would like to remove any items from the consent agenda. Mr. Minicello. Item G and item H. G and H.
Yes, G and H. Yeah.
Anyone else? Okay, hearing no others, then I'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda minus items G and H. Okay, motion's been properly made. Second. Seconded by Mr. Sullivan. All in favor? Approved. Items G and H, Mr. Minicello.
I just want to highlight on item G that we have an acceptance of a Keola scholarship. It looks like it's a $1,000 scholarship from the MBTA. It will be announced to seniors and be available in the VHS guidance offices this year. So we're very appreciative for the funding on that.
Okay, great, so we acknowledge that generous contribution for a scholarship.
And then we have one more generous contribution, a donation from the estate of Jessie Ussis, in memory of her brother Edwin P. Ussis. A scholarship in the amount of $10,000 was received on March 23rd of this year. The donation will be used to set up a scholarship commensurate with the amount of the gift in the name of Edward P. Ussis. Mr. Ussis was a 1943 Brockton High graduate and a graduate of MIT. So we have a good heritage of successful Brockton public school students. So very much appreciated that. We appreciate that generous donation.
Okay.
So unless there's further discussion, I'd make a motion to approve.
I just want to say how appreciative we are, and tonight being a night where before the concert we will attend, they are honoring a distinguished alumni in Steve Bernard. You know, we would like to ask our alumni to remember these students because it does make a difference for some of our students and families, the ability to attend some of the colleges. They get into wonderful colleges and put together packages to attend. So again, if they can remember us in their wills, their estates, any of those things, we would certainly appreciate it.
Smarter financial decisions for both themselves and their families. So it's very
And I'll also let you know that before we get to the end of this calendar year, I was speaking today with Catherine Ledger, our department head of guidance here at Brockton High, and Principal Wolder. And the mayor and I recently had a conversation, and we'll be sharing with you some of the additional scholarships that are coming to our students around graduation time. So I would like them to come before you and talk about scholarships, things they've done to encourage students. So again, that'll be something we do before the end of this calendar year.
Okay, great. We got motions on the table. Has it been seconded? All in favor? Approved. At this time, I'm going to take unfinished business enclosure number 14 out of order. That is the 2016-2017 school year calendar. Everyone should have a copy of it, and Superintendent, I'll turn this over to you.
Okay, as soon as I find my calendar, I'll show it to you.
Let me see if I got mine.
Thank you.
There we go.
At our last school committee meeting, we discussed the calendar for the upcoming 16-17 academic year. There was discussion about starting back, looking at the way that the Labor Day falls, and our contract with our Brockton Education Association members. We can't start before September 1st, so we actually would like teachers to report on that Thursday, September 1st. We would then have the Friday off, which is the start of Labor Day weekend and the Monday. And on the Tuesday, our students would report. We did make a change in our pre-K kindergarten start date to September 15th. We needed a little bit of additional time than what we had originally put on there for screening and making sure that the other children are settled before we welcome our large number of kindergarten students. So that was the only change from last time.
Okay, so this is the time we need some action on this to be approved by the committee?
Please.
Okay. So you've got the school calendar in front of you for the upcoming year, 2016-17, with the one change that the superintendent just described from the last time we reviewed the calendar. At this time, we're looking for a motion to approve the calendar as in front of you now with the one amended change. Okay, Mr. Sullivan? Yep. Okay, seconded by Joyce. We have a motion on the table, properly seconded, to approve the academic calendar that's in front of you with the one change described by the superintendent. All in favor? Approved.
Very good.
At this time, I'll turn the meeting over to the superintendent of schools for her report on teaching and learning.
Right, and I would like to start with our student representative, but filling in this evening is our principal, Sharon Wolder. Just giving you an update, because of our early time here, our students are either getting ready for the concert that's going to happen. Some of them have jobs that don't allow them to get here to these early meetings. So I did want you to hear some of the wonderful things happening at Brockton High.
Good evening. How are you? Nice to see you as well. Just a couple of things. We tested over 1,000 sophomores a couple weeks ago for the ELA MCAS. It was the day after the snow day, and it was a full moon. So it was an exciting day for us, trying to get everybody very focused on MCAS, but they did a phenomenal job. We have two more sets of testing coming up with the math MCAS and the science MCAS in May and June. We're also getting ready for prom season for our juniors. We're coming to the end of the year for our seniors. Our concert choir took a gold medal at the MICA Festival this past weekend, which there were only a few high schools that received gold medals, and we were one of them. So they will be invited to perform either at Symphony Hall or at the hall in Worcester. So in a couple of weeks, they'll be invited to go and perform again. And our drama team went to the state competition, and they were not the state winners. However, we did receive a number of students who were honored as overall best actors, and so they had a great experience there. And for them, it's really exciting to go be able to perform for a number of students and people from all over the state and just have their work, have it honored. And so they did a wonderful job. Now they're moving on to get ready for the musical, so that'll be coming up in May. So this is a very busy season for us, and already we're starting to get ready for graduation.
And I also had the opportunity to go into Boston and see the drama club perform Scapino. I can't tell you, again, going there, how proud we are of our Brockton students, that not only the play itself, but just how they represent themselves when they're with other students from around the Commonwealth. I'm just always proud to be from Brockton. So I want to thank all of these groups for always putting us on the map. I also would like to invite Maxine Richardson, Director of Community Schools, to come down. I wanted you to hear, we had talked recently after the death of James Daly, and we talked about scholarship. Mrs. Sullivan and I had a number of conversations, and it's certainly in your hands, Mrs. Sullivan, but I wanted Maxine, who was in the process of looking throughout the district during scholarship time for programs for community schools, and I'd like her to talk briefly about what this scholarship will be for in the memory of James Daly.
Yes. Good evening, Mayor, Superintendent Smith, and the school committee. And I'm very happy to be here tonight to announce a new scholarship slash campership for two of our students in memory of Jim Daly. And there will be one student from the Brookfield School and one student from the Ashfield School. And they will have a campership to attend one of our summer programs. And that will be of their choice. And we do this because Jim was a great supporter of community schools. And I believe he was on the Community School Advisory Board for quite a while. So on behalf of community schools and the advisory board, we're very pleased to present this these scholarships to two of our students. And it comes at a good time because on Thursday I am meeting with all the school adjustment counselors, and we go over various scholarships that we have in the summertime. So it's a perfect time to do this. So we're really pleased to be able to present that. Thank you.
Thank you, Maxine.
Judy, yes.
And I think Jim's family and himself would be very honored.
Yeah. I'm sure he would be. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Good. Okay, as far as our budget update, again, we continue to work as a committee. We were right back at work today as an executive team. We continue, as we said, by the 15th to have looked at all of the programs that don't necessarily touch our classrooms. Obviously, extracurricular materials, supplies. We are looking at everything for efficiencies, for, again, ways to reduce our budget, all the while keeping our eye on the ball of what's happening with our legislative group. We continue to have conversations with them on a regular basis. The mayor and I met for 2 hours this week. So, you know, as we're developing a city budget and a school budget, we're very much trying to work together to get through this. And I actually, if nothing else, I'm hopeful. I'm hopeful that our message is being heard. We're able to, you know, talk about what our children deserve. And in that line, I also want to say that we had our Brockton Kids Count campaign on Thursday. And, you know, we weren't sure what to expect. We asked parents to come. We want to educate them on the process. As I said to them that evening, and many of you were there to hear that, it was such a large crowd. I'm sorry, some of you I couldn't see till I could see you coming in doors and entrances. There certainly wasn't a seat to be had. I hope you were able to talk to some of your constituents, because there's no finger pointing here. But we do have elected officials, many of them that are supporting us and doing the same hard work. And this has started many, many months ago. So again, last night I had the opportunity, Representative Claire Cronin spoke to the Hancock PAC. And on a night like last night, and if you don't think that there's a movement in Brockton, I would say we had, how many people there last night?
60.
Over 60 people that came out, and you know what last night was like. And they came out, we continued the meeting. Parents have a lot of questions, and they want to help, and they want to advocate, and they want to be part of the process. So I want to thank them. We have demands for lawn signs, although I mentioned to my neighbors, I didn't dare put mine out at this point. Brockton Kids Count, the weather has obviously been terrible. But, you know, we have our signs. I hope we're going to see them all over the city. We have our buttons. People are asking for T-shirts. And this just isn't about a budget. It is about our children, and it is about what our expectations are. Whether we're looking at facilities, and we talked about, again, the facility master plan for the city, not just the schools, but looking for our city to support over the next 20 years what we're going to look like. That people want to come here, they want to take part in the educational system, and they want to be part of our wonderful community that wins all of these awards and all of the things that we provide for our students. Another thing I wanted to mention is people were asking our beginning funding for this program, and I want everybody to hear that we were fortunate in the budget to have money put aside under our strategic plan. We do have family and community engagement as our third pillar. Instructional excellence, safe and supportive schools, and the community engagement. So some of that money was startup money to be able to fund some of these items for our advocacy campaign. We're also sending letters out to businesses. I've talked to Chris Cooney from the Chamber, and we're having discussions about getting support from the community. So there are many things happening. It's happening very, very quickly. We will keep parents updated on a very regular basis, whether it's through our website, social media. We're counting on all of you that when you have your community meetings, I am certainly happy to attend and have discussion with the parents. So again, I want to thank everybody for coming out, not just last night, but Thursday night. I want to say we probably had over 400 people there. I know the Enterprise reported about 100, but we had close to 400 people that signed up, and again, want to make sure that the governor hears loud and clear, you know, please look at our Chapter 70 funding. We're very dependent on our state for a lot of our funding. So again, I want to thank everybody, you know, for their advocacy, and we'll continue to work on the budget. That being said, on the strategic plan update, I am going to have Deputy Superintendent Barry and her team come before you and look at the work that is happening. And when we talked about this back, this is finishing my third year. So it was my first year. We presented it at the end of that first year, and we said that it would not be a document that would collect dust. And in fact, it is not. It's hard work in the district. It absolutely depends on funding that we have, but again, it is instructional excellence in a lot of different areas. We'll have an update so you can see just what the trajectories are, what the targets are, what our goals are, and we'll be presenting that to you in the next couple of weeks, and we'll have our strategic plan update. Also, you had asked for information on class sizes. And you had asked for average class sizes. It becomes a little bit difficult when we look at some classes that take the averages down. I don't want it to be misleading. We're going to give you that information on Friday, but I would like to be able to have the opportunity on Tuesday during our finance meeting to have you take a look at some of the figures that we're able to share with you, and then we'll have a discussion on where we go from here. And we have to remember where community, where kids move in. We're going to have kids move in all summer long, so as we look at rolling over the class sizes now, understand that's a starting point for us. We lose very few kids. What happens during the summer historically is that we actually gain quite a few youngsters for the start of school. So we will have that in your Friday packet and have an opportunity to discuss this with you going forward. The other thing before, and I'm looking at the time, I have to tell you we're trying to work very quickly this evening so we can get people out to attend the concert at Brockton High School. But one of the things that came through this past week, and I did have an opportunity, we were at a Sunday breakfast together, the Breakfast of Champions, that again was a wonderful event. Many of us had the opportunity to attend and celebrate our community leaders that again give back and mentor our children, excuse me. And I had an opportunity to talk to Senator Brady. And there is an act from the Senate, 2203, and it's an act enhancing reform, innovation, and success in education. And I will have not only the summary of this bill, but also all of that information in your packet, because I do think the school committee should take a vote on supporting this legislation. And the legislation is simply this. It talks about if we are going forward with charter, is it really a discussion about lifting the cap? Is it a discussion about wait lists? Is it apples and oranges? And in fact, that's what it always appears to be for those of us sitting in K-12 education. So when you look at some of the components of this act, it talks about governance, transparency, and accountability for charters, similar to the accountability that we have, you know, certainly to the taxpayers and the public in Brockton. encourages collaboration between charter schools and public school districts. It talks about the leveling of the playing field, making sure teachers are certified, making sure they have educator evaluation systems such as we have in place. It supports innovation, where if we are a district and we have been looking at innovation schools in our district, those numbers actually count against the so-called charter numbers that you have if you count those schools that have some autonomy from the contract. But again, these are still would be teachers under our Brockton Education Association. And innovation is something, again, that we would support as a district. And again, promotes fairness in the workplace for charter schools, talks about admissions and retention. And what they mean by that is if you have a business plan and you're a charter that says 315 students on October 1st, it's not okay to lose 30 and 40 of those kids back to the local school district that didn't have the funding for those students. So they would make sure that they continually were able to have students in the charter on a rolling type admission. It modernizes funding. And again, it's something I think that many of us can agree on. Instead of being divisive with charter schools, the city also has to sit down if a charter wants to come to a city with the school district and have conversation about how best to support that school district in a meaningful way for our students. So I would hope that we'd have an opportunity to review this summary. And as I said, this is just coming in. I did talk to Senator Brady on Sunday, and I know he is in support of this bill. So I would hope as a school committee we would be able to take action and support all of it or components of it and let our senator know.
Yep. So the school committee members are just receiving this now for the first time, or it was in the packet on Friday?
No, this is information we're just getting, so I'll put it in the packet.
So we'll take it under advisement for the next meeting. Is that okay with everybody? Give everyone a chance to review it? All right, so we'll take that under advisement, Superintendent, and we'll ask that, Tom, if it's okay with you, maybe we list that as an agenda item for the next meeting for discussion so that public's aware we may talk about it.
And two other things before I turn it over to our presentation tonight from the Downey School, and a short presentation on Marquise Taylor, who has just been named a CNN hero. We'll be showing you those. But I want to bring to your attention, and you probably saw it in the paper, I know, Mr. Sullivan, you had been asking about Chartwell's and student voices. And of course, the meeting that I had scheduled was canceled with our snow day last week. That's being rescheduled. But there was, under our Boxer column, food for thought, and it's our students talking about being an advisory to Chartwell's, taking surveys, having an opportunity to tell them what they like in the menu, innovation going on in other communities that Chartwell serve. So it's a great article. I'll make sure you have that also so you can hear about the student voices and our Chartwell's. The other one that will be in your packet is what is coming out is a behavioral health and social emotional learning position paper by the MASS. I had the opportunity to serve on that committee, and basically what they're talking about right now are what's happening in our schools and our children needing more support emotionally, socially, behaviorally than ever before. And this paper that has been put together by superintendents from suburban, urban, rural districts start to talk about legislation that should be available to make sure that we're supported as a district to support our students. And you know that we sit here every year and talk about additional adjustment counselors, you know, additional support for our students so they can remain in the classroom and deal with some of the issues that they're dealing with. Our schools are trauma-sensitive schools. We continue to get awards. Our teachers continue to present on all of these topics. So I'd like you to take a look at not only the executive summary, but the paper itself. And we'll incorporate that when we start to look at our goals for next year. It ties in very nicely to safe and supportive schools, one of our goals and pillars of our strategic plan. And we'll be able to talk about that in goal setting for certainly the upcoming year. So I've talked very quickly, but I think at this point I'd like to put on, as I said, Marquise Taylor is a graduate of Stonehill College and has come to us, and for a number of years now, through sports, through mentoring, through college collaboration, has supported our youngsters in a number of our middle schools. And recently, he was awarded what is called, I believe, a CNN Heroes Award. And his story is on CNN. And I'd like you to take an opportunity, and we'll show this to the group and have the Downey presentation right after that.
High school and middle school students, they can't see beyond today. They are stuck in their world because they don't know what else is out there. I grew up 10 blocks away from where the riot started, just me and my mom. I struggled academically, I struggled with my own behavior. Basketball kept me out of trouble, but gave me self-confidence.
Does a lot of his own fundraising for this program, but these are, again, some of the decisions we make, and you can see, as I can see, I'm sure, the value of these kinds of programs. It's not only mentoring, it provides an after-school activity and a direction, you know, for our students. So, you know, we continually look for ways to support this program and so many others like it. So we'll have Marquise come at another point, but again, I wanted you to see this. I know that this is going to be out very soon, the CNN Hero Award. Okay, Downey School. Principal John Kelly and his staff. Are you coming alone, Mr. Kelly, or do you have some support? Oh, okay. Well, we're fans.
Thank you.
We're fans.
I'll go sort of quickly in lieu of time here, but I appreciate the opportunity to come here and speak a little bit about what we are at the Downey School and some of the great things we do there day to day. The Downey School, we focus on three traits. That's responsibility, respect, and rigor. Our vision and our mission are similar to all the schools throughout the city. Obviously, each of our buildings are looking to give the students at Brockton the best education we possibly can and to open up their opportunities in life, things like that. What I want to talk to you about with our school is what makes us a little bit different. Every building has different programs, different opportunities in the building. I'm going to speak a little bit about that, and then I want to take you through a day at the Downey School. We have a video we prepared which sort of brings you through what happens at a typical day at the school. So at the school, we do have 655 students. There are 34 classrooms in the building and 110 staff members. As far as the class breakdown goes, we have four kindergarten classrooms, obviously five in the first, second, and third grade, four in the fourth and the fifth. And at each of those grade levels, we do have one inclusion classroom, which is a classroom which is made up of 50% special ed students, 50% regular ed students, or model students. We also, in our building, have seven sub-separate classrooms. We have two primary life skills classrooms. We have three intermediate life skill classrooms. We have one primary city resource classroom, and also a grade 3-4 split emotionally impaired classroom. There are many programs we have. These are some of the programs we highlight throughout the day. We do have PBIS, which most of the schools in the Brockton schools now follow along with. We focus on the positive behaviors, trying to encourage kids instead of focus on the negative. We reward the positive, trying to move forward in that direction. We brought Playworks on board this year. It's a structured recess program, which allows our students to enjoy their time during recess, but it's more of a structure to it, less problems at recess time. We do have breakfast in the classroom now. Most of the schools in the city have come on board with that one by one. We were able to start it in November, so it's our first year with it. But it gives us a great opportunity to get our students into the classroom immediately, get them through breakfast, kind of take that hunger out of their way, and allow them to get right to work and get going with the day. We do start a walk on Wednesdays tomorrow. Not exactly the greatest weather right now, but we are starting to walk into school tomorrow morning. So we reward the children at the front of the building as they come in, try to promote some safe walking on the school streets, but also some healthiness and being outside, moving around. We were fortunate enough, you'll see in the video, to have a dental sealant program come into the school this year, in which every one of our students had the opportunity to have. There were two dental hygienists that came in. They brought their dental chairs with them, and they were able to examine the children's mouths, refer them to dentists if needed, clean their teeth, things like that, so the children learned about the importance of taking care of their teeth and things. We have a partnership with Plymouth Plantation where they've brought field trips to the school. Instead of us going to Plymouth Plantation, they come out to the school. They've been to different grade levels, putting on shows for the kids, enacting some of the scenes, some of the experiences of the pilgrims and the Native Americans. A little bit as far as the enrollment goes, we do have, as I said, 655 students. It changes day to day. We have new students coming in each and every day, but we have about 350 males and about 305 females. As far as the race ethnicity breakout of the school, it's listed there with the school district and the state. Selected population, first language not English, we have roughly 18% of our students. English language learners, we have about 7%. About 20% of our students are students with disabilities. We have a heavy SPED population in the building. High needs, we have 68.2% of our students. About 57% of what we now classify as economically disadvantaged. But if you go back to the old formula, looking at free and reduced lunch, about 90% of our students are qualifying for free and reduced lunch. So some of the things we focus on our building at the Downey School, we have what's called common planning time each and every day with one of our grade levels. It rotates through every 7 days. We meet with one of our grade level groups. It gives them an opportunity to work along with their colleagues to improve their grade level instruction, allows us to focus on data and things like that with them to push our students forward. We've been fortunate to have as many in-service days in the schedule this year as we do. It gives a great opportunity for professional development to take our staff and improve their instruction. And then what I really wanted to focus on today was a video. And this video is something that we prepared to give you a good look at something that happens at the Downey School really each and every day. It's a typical day at the Downey School. If I can get this window to close here, we'll be all set. So this video here is about 11 minutes long, but it does give you a good look at the Downey School, what it is we do each and every day. Try that again. And I think it's coming. It worked when we started. X out and try again.
Electric Avenue, and that's the thing I going to look closely at what's the big question. In what ways do you think African elephants are like us? This is a higher level question. You're going to reread page 15 and think about this, okay? Think about this. What do you need to know? What do we need to find out on that page? I know something about African elephants and people. Okay, please quietly read page 15. Did everybody have a chance to look at it?
Yeah.
Okay, so what do you think? How are African elephants like us?
Please hold up your witness card showing your answer choice
that what you do first in your mind? Okay, so June 1st took the 500 plus 200. And what was that sum? It was 500 plus 200. Okay, so in his mind, we added 500 plus 200 equals 700. Noticing that some of us are depending so much on that algorithm, and that's why we're practicing mental math more. Trying to move away from the hundreds chart, trying to move away from the stacking and the algorithm. So you kept the 800, we didn't touch that 800. 10 plus 13 is 23, so 823. Nice job, Jimmy. Say, let's cheer for Jimmy. We helped him. We helped and supported him a little bit. He raised his hand because he felt like he was close.
Protect your teeth, and helps you to clear cavities.
So that is a day at the Downey School. I can just say that I'm so fortunate to have such a wonderful staff that comes in every day looking to give the best education we can to our students. And that, along with the wonderful students we have and the support of families that come to our door every day, allows the Downey School to be what it is, which is just a school with a great environment and a wonderful learning building. So thank you. Any questions? Or yes, Judy.
And Mr. Kelly is a great principal, very approachable, ready to help anyone with anything. And they also have a really great pack there. It's very small, but they run a lot of good activities for the kids. They just had a 50s dance, and I think last year they had a Hawaiian dance, and they run spaghetti suppers. And
usually different themed dances and different activities for the families throughout the year.
They do a great job there. It's a great school.
Oh, thank you.
I'll just add my comment. Five of my children attended the Downey School, so I have a long time personal connection with the Downey. My grandson is there now, and I couldn't be happier with the education and services he gets. He has a great experience at the Downey, and he's making tremendous progress thanks to the people there. So I personally appreciate the people at the Downey. And thank you, Mr. Kelly.
Thank you.
Mr. Sullivan.
Yes, just wanted to say it was an excellent video. It was plain to see all these kids and teachers were all having a good time. It was like watching a regular movie. Nice job.
I have to give some credit to a retired Brockton Public Schools teacher, Dick Oso, who actually helped put the video. We had done the taping of the activities and that, but Dick helped put it together, and some of the special effects are beyond my capability, but it did come out fantastic.
Mr. I just had two quick questions.
Sure.
On the dental sealant, is that free for the kids?
Yes, it is. It's a program through the Mass Department of Public Health, and they go into different schools. There have been a few different schools in the city here in Brockton, but not one of our students paid a dime. They came in, they got the cleaning. If they do need work done, they get referrals to a dentist. At that point, the family takes on that responsibility, but everything you saw happening at the school there was free of charge for every student that wanted to sign up.
So if there is a cavity, they don't do nothing there, they have to go?
No, at that point, they go to the dentist, they do a follow-up with their own dentist. But at least it helps identify maybe what the issue is.
The other thing was this Plymouth Plantation.
Yes.
Comes to you.
They came to us.
That's a little reversed. I never heard of that.
For the last couple of years, they've come. Last year, they came as the Native Americans, and they showed how their life, their daily life went on. They went to some of our kindergarten and second grade classrooms. And then this year, they came as Miles Standish. And Miles Standish came, gave a presentation from that point of view of the pilgrims coming over and their life back over in England. They do a great job. They come in costume and in character.
Oh, wow.
And so, it's pretty powerful. And again, it's something that they're donating to us. It was through a grant we received. So we're partnering with them, and they'll be in next year also. So
nice.
It's nice.
Nice job. Thank you.
Thank you.
I apologize for the discussion a little bit short, but we have to get next door for the concert and the presentation of the Alumni Awards. So
thank you, everyone.
Kelly, thank you very much for the great presentation.
Thank you, Kelly.
Does anyone have new business that they can do in less than a minute? Lisa,
good job.
Lisa.
I just wanted to mention the Self-Care Leadership Conference going on April 30th. This free conference is designed to empower South Shore community members. Their goal is to build leadership skills to enable local residents to become actively engaged in advocacy work in their communities. This is on April 30th at the Stonehill College from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m.
Okay, thank you. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? Let's go next door.